Today's Bible reading is from Mark 2, verses 1 to 12. A few days later, when Jesus again entered Capernaum, the people heard that he had come home. They gathered in such large numbers that there was no room left, not even outside the door, and he preached the word to them. Some men came, bringing to him a paralyzed man, carried by four of them. Since they could not get him to Jesus because of the crowd, they made an opening in the roof above Jesus by digging through it and then lowered the mat the man was lying on. When Jesus saw their faith, he said to the paralyzed man, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some teachers of the law were sitting there, thinking to themselves, "Why does this fellow talk like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Immediately, Jesus knew in his spirit that this was the way that they were thinking in their hearts, and he said to them, "Why are you thinking these things? Which is easier, to say to this paralyzed man, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Get up, take your mat, and walk'? But I want you to know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the man, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." He got up, took his mat, and walked out in full view of them all. This amazed everyone, and they praised God, saying, "We have never seen anything like this."
Thanks, Emma. And we have the privilege of having Jeane come and share the message. So we look forward to what you have to say to us. Thanks, Jeane.
We on? Oh, yeah. There you go. The joys. Well, good morning at WIC Ryde. So lovely to see you all here today. So such a joy and an honour and a privilege to be sharing the message with you today. I want to extend the wishes for a Mother's Day, Happy Mother's Day to all our mums, but also to every woman here who is perhaps a spiritual mum or an auntie, somebody who cares. Happy Mother's Day to everyone. And as has been acknowledged, it's not always an easy day. And I pray that if it is a struggle for you, that God is going to be comforting you. Very warm welcome to those who might be visiting with us today. Are there any visitors here today? No? Okay, great. All right. So as you know, our theme this year is freedom. And we're currently in February, we did Vision Month, and then in March and April, we did Freedom and the Exodus, and that we're now into a new series called Jesus and Freedom. So Pastor Andy would have preached the first of those sermons last week, and today we're going to be, I will be doing the next one. So as we come to God's Word, let's pray. Loving God, we thank you for your Word, which reveals your heart, which reveals who you are, which reveals how you relate to us and how we're to relate to you. It is such an enormous gift, Lord. We see you everywhere, everywhere in nature. But it's only your word that reveals exactly who you are. And so, Lord, as we come before you now, we come in a posture of humility and surrender. We say, Holy Spirit, would you have your way amongst us? I pray that there would be anointing for myself, Lord. I pray that, Holy Spirit, you would speak through me and from me, that I would not say one word that is not from your throne, that I would say not one word that is not aligned to Scripture. But most importantly, Holy Spirit, we pray that you would be doing a work in all of our hearts, that the word that goes forth will settle and will bring life in every single one of us. So, Lord, we need your help. Apart from you, Jesus, we are nothing and can do nothing. And so we pray, Lord, that you would have your way in this time. Have your way amongst us, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, so we're in the series of freedom. But have you ever asked yourself, what does it mean to be free? What is freedom? What does freedom feel like? For each of us here today, it might look quite different, right? For some of us, we might think, oh, it would be so good not to have to go to work. and have the stress and the pressure and everything upon us, right? That would feel like freedom, not to have to deal with that. For some of us, it might be just to have nobody to have to care for and be responsible for and wash the dishes and clean the house. So I'm sure there are a number of mums here today are kind of going, oh, maybe we'll have a bit of freedom today because the kids are going to be doing some stuff. But just not to have the pressure of having people needing you all the time. Freedom for some of you might be not having the aches, the pains, perhaps the sickness in your body that might be limiting you and limiting you from being able to move and do whatever it is that you want to do. And for some of us, this is what freedom looks like, right? How many of you wish you were there right now, right? Being able to just go wherever, hang out. I mean, that to me is just the picture of freedom. No responsibility, no worries, no nothing, all right? And if we look at what a definition of freedom is, quite a good definition is the ability to determine action without restraint, right? You can do what you want to do when you want to do it. This is what would be defined as freedom. And we all want it, don't we? We all want freedom. We all want this, we have this desire to be free. But have you ever asked yourself, why? Why do I want to be free? What is it about freedom and this thing that I want? Why? Well, actually, it's actually probably got less to do with the situation that you're in and actually what's going on inside of you. Because if we've got freedom and we go to those beautiful places or we've got some time and space, it's actually about joy, isn't it? I want to be free so I can be happy. I want to be free so I can feel joy and peace and excitement. So freedom actually has less to do with the sometimes the situation that we find ourselves in or the context of what's going on around us than what's actually going on inside of us. You can be more free in a prison than over here. Let me give you an example. So you're sitting there, you're having your cocktails. Looks like it's Fiji or one of those amazing islands where all of us would love to be right now. But you're sitting there and you think, oh, could be nothing freer than this, nothing more amazing than this. And somebody comes to you and says to you, you've been scammed. You know that text that you thought you got from your kid? Well, all of your money's gone. Do you think you'd be feeling free right there? No. Well, you might get some bad news. Somebody's got lost or is left, right? A context doesn't necessarily determine freedom. It's really what is going on inside of us that actually determines whether we're free or not. You can be in a prison and be free. You can be out on an island, on a boat, and you can be not free. Now, from the reading that we had today, the man that they bring to Jesus, you talk about being constrained. He cannot move. He's paralyzed. And his friends have obviously heard about Jesus, right? And they bring this man to Jesus, right? Knowing and have got such faith. They dig through the roof. They drop him down. And Jesus looks at the man and they're like, they're bringing him for healing. And what does Jesus say? Jesus says to him, son, first of all, son, right? Meaning that there is family. And then the next thing he says to this man is, your sins are forgiven. Now, can you imagine what might have been going on in the minds of those friends who brought this man to Jesus? And I've been thinking, we've just dug through the roof. We didn't bring him here for forgiveness of sins. We brought him here to get healed. Jesus, what are you doing? Your sins are forgiven. Why would Jesus do that? Why would he do it? Perhaps he knew that when he healed this man, he might go home. And he might be still feeling guilty. Perhaps he had cursed God for his disability. Perhaps he'd got impatient with not being able to move. Perhaps he was jealous and envious of those around him. Perhaps he was bitter for the way that people had reacted towards him. Perhaps he would have gone home and gone, "I am not worthy of this. You know who I am." Perhaps Jesus knew that one day this man's body would stop working and he would die and he would be facing his maker, the maker of the universe, the judge of the world, the judge before whom nobody can stand because he cannot have sin in his presence. Perhaps Jesus knew that the greater need of this man was forgiveness, not physical healing, not a changing of his circumstances, but actually what is going on inside of him. And of course, the Pharisees are shocked by this. They're okay with the healing. They're okay with the healing, right? Yes, it's fine. He's a healer. But who can forgive sin except God alone? Because the reality is that we might sin against one another, but ultimately all sin, all wrongdoing, all rebellion goes against God. And ultimately, who alone can forgive sin? Only God. Now, interestingly, what does Jesus say about himself here? Which is easier to say, get up and walk, or your sins are forgiven. So in this moment, Jesus is revealing who he is. He says, "I'll show you that I have the authority to do this, and I'm going to do this thing to show you that I am actually God," because nobody just says, "get up and walk." Right? I'm going to bring this power. And that is the reality we see from Scripture. God reveals to us who he is and how we come to him, right? Sin, our wrongdoing is so awful to God. We sang this morning, "Holy, holy, holy." He cannot have it in his presence, right? But he is so loving. And he's created us to be in relationship with him, that we have to be in his presence. He wants us in his presence, but he has got this dilemma. And what we need to understand about the spiritual realm, I'm sure there's a number of lawyers here today, it is very legalistic. The spiritual realm is very legalistic, right? It is very just and it's very legalistic, right? And because of who God is, we cannot come into his presence. And so we see that in the Old Testament, when God says to the Israelites, he says, I want you to be in this relationship. I want you to obey me. Here are the laws, obey me. And the whole thing is to be in relationship with him, but also to reflect who he is. And Israel go, yeah. We're going to do it. And, you know, Moses goes up the mountain, and within like the first 10 minutes, they've already making themselves an idol. And they're breaking the first commandment. You shall have no other gods but me. So God's in a dilemma now. He loves them. He wants to be in relationship with them. But justice also has to be done. And there is holiness that has to be done. And so we see what he does is he puts the sacrificial system in place. Right? Puts the sacrificial system in place. Your sins can be forgiven if you bring me your big cow, right, which would be like your home in Bondi, your bull, your animal, the things, and the most perfect one. And when you shed that blood and you come asking forgiveness and really repenting because of that shed blood of that animal, you can be forgiven. So we see that in Hebrews it says, you know, in fact, the law required that nearly everything be cleansed with blood. And without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. Now, it's weird, right? And we might not all understand it, but this is what God says. If you want to come to me, there's got to be the shedding of blood. And then, of course, we have Jesus who comes, and he becomes the one, God himself, because only God can forgive sins. You have the perfect sacrifice. When Jesus comes, he is sinless and he is perfect, and he's saying, I'm going to give myself as a sacrifice, right? I'm going to shed my blood for you so that as you come in repentance and put your faith in what I've done on the cross for you, what that blood that's been shed, that you are washed clean, that you can come into the presence of God, right? And that's the only way. And because of that, right, from that point, he not only, when Jesus goes to the cross, he not only pays for the sin, but he reconciles us to God. So he brings us together. And then finally, we see that there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. No condemnation. Because through Jesus Christ, the law of the Spirit who gives you life sets you free from sin and death. If you think about it, all right, we're also told in other parts of Scripture that we are, Jesus purchased. He purchased us from God, for God. Who's he purchased us from? Satan, right? Because the only way that we can go to God is through the blood, and the only way we can get into his presence. If we don't go there, we are told in the Scriptures there is an enemy of our souls. And that enemy is the accuser of the brethren, right, in Revelation 12, verse 10. Right, so there is a spiritual reality that's going on, and Satan knows that without the shedding of blood, there is no coming to God. And God says, this is the way that you come to me, right? So if we really, truly want to be free, ultimately our whole freedom, ultimately freedom is only found in God. There's a God-sized hole in all of us, and there's an eternity that we can only come and be with him for eternity through the blood of the Lamb. And that is the way, that is ultimate freedom. That has you, that when you find yourself in any circumstance, you can know that you are loved because Jesus died for you. You can know that you have hope and eternal life and that God is in relationship with you. So there is this relationship. Now, if you've not put your faith in that today, if you've not yet put your faith in Jesus, I really want to encourage you today. Don't wait for a minute. Nobody knows what's going to come up in life. None of us know when our time is up. But for many of us here, I'm conscious that this message and this, we've heard this over and over and over again, and you are kind of go, yep, I put my faith in the blood of Jesus. I worship God. I love him. I'm assured of my salvation. But then why? Why don't I feel free? Why do I feel perhaps bitter? Why have I got all this anger that's inside of me? Why don't I have joy that I'm supposed to have? Why don't I feel free, even though I know that I've been set free, even though I know that I have been purchased for God? I've had this question very often over and over again in my life. You know, the reality is that you can be in the best, you can have all the material possessions in the world, you can be sitting in a place like this, and actually those thoughts, sometimes when you're in the nice place, when you're away from everything, it all comes bubbling up, doesn't it? And you start thinking, ugh, you start getting bitter, you start getting angry, you're in a beautiful place, but you're actually in a prison. And so what is it to actually get true freedom when you're in this place, right? And what I've found is that there's two ways that I, in my own life, and the way I see that we get kept in bondage. The first one is not forgiving self, all right? Don't know if you've ever had this. You know, you committed a sin ages ago. you've come to God, you've asked him for forgiveness, and you're doing something else, and the memory comes back of what you've done, and you're like, oh, I'm such a worm, such a bad person. Oh, please forgive me, please forgive me. I don't know if it's happened to you, but it happens to me all the time. And I kind of go, and I'm like, Lord, please forgive me. And one day he's like, kid, I've done that ages ago. It's gone. You're the one who's holding on to it. You're the one that is holding on to it, right? Tim Keller has a very, very good point. His book on forgiveness, highly recommended. I think it was written in 2021, 22, but really brilliant. And he says, here is the essence of what Christianity gives us. Only God is the final judge of who we are and of what we have done. Only God can overrule our heart's guilt and self-condemnation. If he says we are forgiven, then we are. And we can tell our hearts to be quiet. God's word, which is truth, says if we confess our sins, he is faithful and he is just and will forgive our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Tell your heart to be silent. Tell the accuser of the brethren that the Lord has taken that sin and he's thrown it into the heart of the sea. When he's wiped it away, it's done. All right? And that we've really got to speak to ourselves and speak to our hearts in this thing. Say, look, I've brought it. I'm sorry. It's gone. It's gone. And let it go. The second way that I feel that, you know, we stay in bondage is actually not forgiving others. Not forgiving others, right? And, you know, a lot of psychologists and people say that forgiveness of others is a conscious and a deliberate decision to release feelings of resentment, hatred, or vengeance toward a group or a person who has harmed you, right? Hatred, vengeance, bitterness. When those feelings are coming up in us, there is no freedom. It doesn't matter where you are and it doesn't matter what you're doing. There is no freedom, right? But forgiving others, if forgiving self is hard, forgiving others can be really, really tough, right? We see C.S. Lewis, I love this quote. He says, you know what? We all think forgiveness is a beautiful idea until we have to practice it, isn't it? It's really hard when somebody's done something really awful to you. It's really, really hard to consciously decide to release those feelings of resentment, hatred, or vengeance. But the truth is that if we're in God, if we have put our faith in Jesus Christ, we really have to. In Ephesians 4, 26 to 27, Paul says, in your anger, do not sin. Do not let the sun go down while you are still angry. And do not give the devil a foothold. Where does the devil get a foothold? On the soul. Because if you're angry, you're bitter. And if you're bitter and you keep feeding that, the enemy gets stronger and stronger, right? This is not just a case of releasing. This is actually a war with the enemy of our souls, right? With the enemy of our souls, the accuser of the brethren, the one who gets a grip and keeps us from feeling free. But it's not easy, right? We can hear this, forgive, forgive. And I went on my own journey. I've had to forgive so many people as so many people have to give me. A while back, just a few weeks ago, I was preaching about my time in the wilderness. And in my early 30s, I was married, and unfortunately, my husband actually started having multiple affairs and doing a whole lot of things behind my back, and just went through this awful, awful time of having my marriage broke down. Losing absolutely everything. You know, I lost my hopes, my dreams, my material possessions. It was like wipe out, you know. And particularly I think the hopes and the dreams were really tough. And I was in a really depressed place, really angry place. I remember lying on a bed and saying, oh, Lord Jesus, you know, could you know? Can you know how this feels? And he was like, yep, Jeane, I did. I did when I was on the cross. I know where you're at. And I saw God provide, right? I saw him provide work. I saw him provide. I saw him heal. I saw him really give me what I need, right? Being faithful. Unfortunately, though, I was pretty angry. And there was night after night after night that I went to bed really angry. And I was like, oh, playing it over and over and over again in my mind, hating him, wishing that things, that the worst thing could happen to him, wishing he could have the suffering that I had, and just going over and over and over. And one day, I'm sitting in traffic on Parramatta Road. Now, if you've ever been on Parramatta Road, man, you're always stuck in traffic on that road. Loved it in COVID. I was like, there was no traffic. I thought, I'm never going to see this again. But generally, I'm sitting in traffic on Parramatta Road, and I'm sitting on Parramatta Road, and I'm thinking again, I'm like, oh, you know, what he did to me. I mean, we split up and moved on. I'm like, what did he do to me? I just hate him. Da, 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 da. And then in that moment, I'm sitting there, and I just knew it was a Holy Spirit moment, because it's like God just dropped the parable into my mind. It's a parable that is found in Matthew chapter 18. And it's a story that Jesus tells when Peter comes to him and says, you know, how many times shall I forgive my brother when he sins against me? Seven times? Jesus says, no, not seven times, but 77 times. And the story goes like this, right? There once was a king. And this king decided he needed to clear up his debts. And so he was bringing in all his servants who owed him debts. And there was a servant who owed him 10,000 bags of gold. And the king says, well, you can't, he says, you know, I can't pay it. He said, right, we're going to sell your family. We're going to sell them as slaves to pay for your debts. And, you know, that's what's going to happen. And the servant goes before the king and he says, please, please, please have mercy on me. I will get the money. Can you just have mercy on me? And the king was just so kind and compassionate. And he said, you know what, I'm going to do better than just having mercy on you. I'm going to wipe that debt clean, all right? No more 10,000 bags of gold. You don't owe it. You and your family are free to go. Anyway, that merciful servant goes out, right? And then he sees his fellow servant who owes him like 100 silver coins. And he gets him by the neck and he grabs him. He says, pay me what you owe me. And the servant falls on his knees and says, please, 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 just be patient with me. I will get you your money. But he says, no, I'm going to have you thrown into prison. So he has him thrown into prison. Well, the other servants who watched all of this look at this and go, oh, my goodness, how could that happen? And they go to the king and they say to the king, you know, you let this guy off with so much money, 10,000 worth, you know, of gold and all this money. And he just owed this little bit. But he had him thrown into prison. And we read that the king burned with anger. And he had the servant brought back and he said to him, I forgave you that sin. I forgave you that debt because you asked me. I wiped it out. Couldn't you have done the same to your fellow servant? And then he said to him, you know what? Go back. I'm going to throw you back into prison. You can stay there until you have paid the debt. And friends, in that moment, I realized I was the unmerciful servant in that story. God had forgiven me so much. He forgives me so much every day, and yet I'm holding on to this bitterness and this vengeance against, you know, my husband. Yes, he did wrong, but also every marriage takes two to tango. I was not perfect. I was not sinless. Our sins might have been different, but they were both. And that's where God started taking me on a journey of forgiveness. What's scary after that parable, Jesus says, now this is how my heavenly Father will treat each of you unless you forgive your brother or sister from your heart. Right, it's deep. Now, does that mean that our forgiveness earns God's forgiveness? No, because we only get God's forgiveness from what Jesus did on the cross. Tim Keller once again says this perfectly. He says, "This does not mean that we can earn God's forgiveness through our own forgiving, but we can disqualify ourselves from it. No heart that is truly repenting toward God can be forgiving toward others. A lack of forgiveness toward others is a direct result of a lack of repentance toward God. And as we know, you must repent in order to be saved." So we don't earn God's forgiveness through our forgiveness, but is as a result of the freedom that we've realized that we have, right? It's that it's like, oh my goodness, this is who I am. This is how serious my sin is to God. This is what Jesus has done on the cross. Who would I be if I did not pass it on? And you know what? We're talking about that legality in the spiritual realm. You've got to realize that the enemy of our souls is in this as well. You know, we see in Job, he goes and he stands before God. God says, "Have you considered my servant Job?" And we see in Revelation that it says he is the accuser of the brethren. There is a legality in the spiritual realm. And he's like, well, this person hasn't forgiven. They say they've got you and they haven't forgiven. How can you forgive when they've not forgiven? Right? So there is a legality that goes on. It's a realization of what Jesus has done for us. But also in the spiritual realm, it's like, well, actually, we are called to pass that on and for us to really realize what that is. Now, it's not easy. And how do we do it? How do we forgive from our heart? Well, the first thing is to recognize the hurt before God, right? It's not, you know, a lot of people say, okay, well, you know, I just going to push it under the carpet. I've forgiven. Going to just push it under the carpet. We're not going to talk about it anymore ever again. That's done. But I will never forget. I will never forget. That is not forgiveness, right? It is an acknowledgement that what has been done to you is wrong, all right? What the person did to you is wrong. You have every right to be angry, but it's where you take your anger to, right? It's bringing it to God and saying, this wrong has been done before me, and acknowledging that, right? And I know that in this room there will be people who've had horrendous things done to them, much worse than anything that I've ever lived for. And then it's not right. What others have done to you, where they've hurt you, is not right. But it is a case of bringing that pain and that hurt before the Father. And then releasing it, saying, Lord, I release it to you. I give it to you. I release them to you. Just as you have taken my sin, I release their sin against me to you. All right? It's releasing. And then here is the big one. Refuse to dwell on the hurt or do harm or wish harm on that person. Now, the Lord convicted me. I needed to forgive my husband, right? And I was like, okay, I'm going to do this. I'm going to forgive him. And I wrote it all out. I actually even wrote him a letter, like, forgiven. I'm like, okay, right, we feel light. It's off, and off it went. And about 3 weeks later, I'm like, oh, the anger, the bitterness is back. I'm just, you know, wishing that he's having the most terrible time of his life. And I'm going, what's happened here? I thought I'd forgiven. I thought I'd released. I thought this was over and I was free. And that's when the Holy Spirit started teaching me that forgiveness is actually a process. Sometimes you have to forgive the same person 77 times over for the same sin. And it's important, right? The enemy is going to bring it back to you because we have these memories. But it is important to go, you know what? I've released forgiveness. I continue to release it back to him. I am not going to wish that person harm. I wish them all the very best. And to keep doing that every time it comes up. Every time it comes up. Right? Over and over and over again. Don't be worried or concerned when you find this happening again, because you kind of go, okay, we're gonna bring it before God again, we're gonna release it again, and we're not gonna hold on to that. The fourth R of forgiveness is restore the relationship if possible. All right, restore the relationship if possible. Now, God is all about restoring, right? That's why Jesus died. We can have this reconciliation. He wants us to be in relationship. I think Pastor Andy would have preached last year about you bring your gift to the altar, go and restore the relationship with the person who's wronged you, all right? So ultimately, that is it. Now, for some of us, we can't restore relationship. Perhaps the person who's hurt us has died. Perhaps that person doesn't want to get into contact. Perhaps, you know, it's that person doesn't want to deal with forgiveness, all right? And you have no control over that, and that's okay. But where you can, it's actually important. And remember, sin begets sin. If somebody sinned against you, you will very often start sinning against them as well. So it's this asking for forgiveness. Now, I went through a process, and it took me years and years to forgive my ex-husband. But one day I'm sitting, and it's his birthday, and I'm sitting in my room, and I'm praying, and I'm going, oh, yeah, it would be okay. If he walked in the room right now, I've forgiven him. And I hear Holy Spirit say to me, okay, so text him. Text him. And I was like, what? I don't even know if I've got his number, and now I've got to get in contact. But I knew that God wanted me to get in contact with him. And so, and this, he was the type of person who would just like, when he cut you off and when life was done, it was done with you, right? But I thought, well, God's telling me to do this. And so I texted him for his birthday, and I said, look, I wish you a really happy birthday, and I really hope that you're happy, and I hope you have a great life. And he surprisingly came back and said, thank you very much. You know, and he said, I hope you're happy because, you know, you deserve it. And I said, look, I really am happy. Ultimately, we weren't meant to be together. I said, but I actually want to ask your forgiveness for the, you know, we weren't meant to be together. Our marriage wasn't going to work. But I want to ask you forgiveness for the stuff that I did that broke down our marriage, that was part of breaking down our marriage. And, you know, I think highly of you. I have positive thoughts about you, and I've done wrong, and I want to ask for your forgiveness. And he came back and he said, you know, absolutely. And then he asked me for my forgiveness of what he had done. And it was just such this beautiful moment. We never had to see each other. It wasn't about, you know, it wasn't actually about being, you know, a relation, but there was this moment. And I was really grateful that God prompted me to do that, because shortly after that, he passed away. You know, and so I was very, very grateful. And so, you know, really, God's heart is about upward relationship with him and sideward relationship with others. That if there is at all possible, that for complete freedom is restoration. I know it's not always possible, but that's, you know, and that once again can take time. It takes time, and it's in God's timing. And then the final R is repeat and repeat and repeat, all right? Forgiveness is not a one-off event, right? The greater the sin, the harder it is. And it gives us a perspective of really how hard it is for God to forgive. If it's hard for us, can you imagine? He's got 7 billion, the sins of 7 billion people coming against him, right? But forgive we must. Bringing ourselves to this process, we absolutely must, right? Because we do not want to have the enemy have, you know, that foothold on our souls. We don't want to be held in bondage, because then we're not free. If we're held in bondage, it's much harder to do ministry. It's much harder to share Jesus, because they cannot see your joy. When Paul's talking to the Galatians, he says to them, it is for freedom that Christ has set you free. And here he's actually talking about circumcision. But I want, you know, in our day, it's really important for us to remember that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. And then he says to them, stand firm then and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. Unforgiveness is a yoke of slavery. We've not been called to that. We've not been purchased for that. We have actually been purchased for freedom. I'm going to pray. And we've specifically moved communion to after the message, because we're really going to really reflect on God's forgiveness for us, for what he's actually done for us, and the reason why we really are called to release others from what they've and forgive them for what they've done for us. So let us pray. God of all mercy and compassion, we thank you. Oh, we thank you, Jesus. We thank you that you came to set us free. That your desire and your heart was for us to be in this beautiful, free, and open relationship with you and with one another. Lord, as we come to this communion table, you tell us not to take it lightly. And we come laying our hearts bare before you, Lord. Jesus, right now, we ask you to help us to release everyone who has hurt us in the past week, in the past year, perhaps in the rest of our lives. And only you can help us to release, or you know how tight the chains of unforgiveness can be. We bring them to you. We bring those chains. We lay them at your feet. You know that our hearts are not always right before you, Lord. We thank you, Jesus, that you went to that cross to make a way. And so we come and we bring our hearts before you and we ask for your forgiveness. Cleanse us with your blood, Lord Jesus. Cleanse us and set us free. And so, Lord, as we come to this time of communion, as we come to this time taking the sacrament that you've given us to remember what you've done for us so that we can be free. Be present, Lord. Be present in our hearts. Be present around us. Speak to us. Help us to release and let go all the hurt, all the pain, all the shame. In Jesus' name, amen. So friends, we come to this really special time. We come to the sacrament that has been celebrated for over 2,000 years. We come to remember our relationship, our communion with God and our communion with one another. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you that in you we live and we move and we have our being. We thank you, God, that you created us to love us. You created us to pour out your affection. Just as we pour our affection out on our own little babies, Lord, you created us to be in this relationship with you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that you love us more than we could ever love ourselves. Lord, you know that from the time of Adam and Eve in the garden, from the time that the enemy came to tempt us, we have been a rebellious people, running from you then, running from you and being rebellious towards you. in the past year, in the past week, Lord. We have rebelled against you, and all sin is unholiness, and we cannot be in your presence, Lord. Cannot be in your presence with our sin. And yet, Lord, you loved us so much. You loved us so much that you came down in the person of your Son, Jesus, the only one who has authority to forgive sins. He showed us who you are. He taught us about you. And then he went to that cross to die on that cross, to shed his blood so that we could be cleansed, so that we could be forgiven, so that we could be restored into relationship with you. What a precious and amazing gift. We thank you that Jesus overcame death when he rose 3 days later on the cross, and that we can have a sure faith and a sure knowledge of our forgiveness because Jesus rose from the dead. And he called us to put our faith in what he's done, to believe in him, so that we could be set free and have eternal life. We thank you, Lord. We thank you. You're so gracious. We have that indescribable gift. But when Jesus rose into heaven, he did not leave us alone. He came. He sent the Holy Spirit to come and to dwell in us and to be around us, to empower us to live lives that honor you and help others to come to know you. We thank you, Lord. We thank you for that gift. We thank you for every single gift that you give us. But mostly we thank you, Jesus. We thank you for the gift of yourself. You're such a precious God. And we thank you for everything that you've given us. And friends, we remember that on the night that Jesus shared that last Passover meal with his disciples, the night before he was going to go to the cross for our sin, the night when he would be hanging on that cross and looking down and having everybody hurling insults at him and him crying out to God saying, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." One of his last acts was forgiveness and asking for forgiveness. The night when one of his closest and dearest friends would betray him, Jesus took bread, and after giving thanks to God the Father, he broke the bread and he gave it to his disciples saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat it. This is my body, which is given for you." And after supper, he took the cup. And again, after giving thanks to God the Father, he gave the cup to his disciples and said, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of your sins." Friends, when we eat this bread, we drink this cup, we remember what Jesus has done for us. He has won freedom. Freedom now, freedom into eternity, freedom to live fully, both now and forevermore. Holy Spirit, we thank you that you are always with us and in us and around us. But we pray now, Lord. We pray that you would come more fully on us and on these gifts as we take them, remembering what Jesus Christ did on the cross for us. And it's in his name that we pray. Amen. Friends, let's eat the bread, remembering that Jesus' body was broken for us. And let us drink from the cup, remembering Jesus' forgiveness of our sins, that his blood was shed so that we can be cleansed, forgiven, and set free. God, we thank you that you have fed us in this feast and reminded us of the eternal feast, the eternal banquet of freedom and joy and peace where there will be no more tears, where there will be no more restrictions. We thank you, Lord, that because of what Jesus did, we can be free now and into eternity. And we pray, Lord, that we would be able to share communion meals with those who are not yet free, with those with whom we've had conflict in our lives, Lord, that communion will be restored, and that most importantly, that we will all put our faith in you, Jesus, and trust you and move forward in your spirit. We pray all these things in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people said, Amen. Friends, let's stand and sing Amazing Grace. Just want to take a seat. We're just going to have a little bit of ministry time right now, just in the presence of the Spirit. Holy Spirit, it's only you who can work on our hearts. It's only you who can bring life and healing and transformation. In the name of Jesus, we welcome you. And we ask you right now to do your work in our hearts. There might be some here today who have not yet put their faith in what Jesus did on that cross, but not received his forgiveness. And today I just want to encourage you, just in the privacy of your seat, just to pray this prayer in your heart. Lord Jesus Christ, I am so sorry for all of my sin, for all of my rebellion. I thank you that you went to the cross to shed that blood for me, so that my sins could be washed away, so that I could be purified before God. I put my faith in what you have done on the cross for me. I repent of my sin, and I ask you to come and to live within me. Be my Lord and be my Savior. Thank you, Lord Jesus. For others of us, we might be sitting here right now and thinking, yeah, I've got to forgive. And it is a process, but we just want to ask Holy Spirit right now, just as you ask him, allow him to just drop that person in front of you, the one that you've got to release. The one who's hurt you perhaps the most. See Jesus right there, and you know that it's hard. You know that it's really hard. It's really painful. I want you just to see Jesus come in, put his hand on you, and just help you. Help you. Lay it at his feet. Release that person. Release them in the name of Jesus. Give it to him. See him taking it. I was telling him, knowing who you are before him, knowing that you are forgiven, that he's forgiven you for all of your sin, you can release it. You know who that person is, and this is between you and him and God. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, release it to him. Well, we want to thank you. We want to thank you for the fact that we can release. We forgive, we release it. We tell that bitterness to go in the name of Jesus. We tell the anger to go in the name of Jesus. We tell the conflict to go in the name of Jesus. We tell low self-esteem to go in the name of Jesus. We tell rejection to go in the name of Jesus. We tell self-hatred to go in the name of Jesus. We tell every feeling, every hurt that is holding us captive to go in the name of Jesus. We release it. We release it to you, Lord. Holy Spirit, would you just be filling every single one of us. Fill us afresh. Fill the gaps on the soul. Set us free, Lord, we pray. I'm seeing, I feel that the Lord, there's somebody who's got some issues with, just seeing a lot of blackness in the stomach area, a lot of struggles in this kind of abdomen area. Holy Spirit, would you just be bringing healing to the body, Lord. Healing to that part of the body right now. And I just want to encourage you, if you need any healing at all, be it emotional healing, be it spiritual healing, just keep your eyes closed, put your hands up and just receive. Lord, we want to pray for all of those here today who perhaps need healing of bones, joints, ligaments. Blood disorders, we tell you to go in the name of Jesus. Anxieties, be healed in the name of Jesus. Asthma, we command healing in the name of Jesus. Receive that healing. Depression, we command depression to lift in the name of Jesus. Right knee. Somebody's got pain in the right knee. It's got a problem with the right knee. Right now, we proclaim healing. Jesus, would you be healing that knee in the name of Jesus? Heal it now, and we pray. Lord, you know the needs in this room. You know the needs for employment. You know the needs for healing. You know the needs for provision. But mostly you know the need for forgiveness and freedom. And so, Lord, we just pray that even now, Holy Spirit, that you would release it. You're the God who releases freedom. So be ministering to each one's heart. We receive it. We thank you, Lord, that you are for us, that you're a good, good father, and you're a good, good mother, and you're a good parent, and you will never let us fall. We thank you, Lord, that in your presence there is freedom. We receive it. May your peace rest upon your people, Lord. May we move forward in joy. May all anxiety, all worry, all fear go in the name of Jesus, knowing that you are a God of your promises. You tell us that you will provide. You tell us that you will care for us and that you will not let us go. And so we bring it all, Jesus. We lay all of that burden down before you. We lay it at your feet. We say, have it, Lord, so that we can be free. We pray all of this in the mighty name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. Now, friends, as we go from this place, go in the freedom that the Spirit has set you free for, that Jesus has set you free for. Go and help to release the captives in his name and in his power, praying continuously, focusing on him, and sharing his love with everyone. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, may you all be blessed and be filled with his peace and his joy. Amen.